Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this webinar being organized by Vega Schools. My name is Shivani Malhotra, and I work with Vega Schools as the Director Strategy and Head of HR. I'm sure you all will agree with me that the current times have put a pause to our lives, and they've also unfortunately put a pause to the lives of our children. We're forced to, shut schools. Children are stuck indoors. But we are doing online classes for the last 3 months. But life certainly has changed for our little ones. But as we're opening up, most of us are gearing to go back to our respective workplaces. I'm sure the time will come again soon when our children will be packing their bags and will be all excited to go back to school. But that's, of course, depending on whenever we reopen. But as a parent, the thought of sending my child to school in these times does raise a few questions in my mind, both as a parent and as an educator, on the kind of precautions that we would need to take once we reopen schools. And to discuss this very relevant topic, a topic which is, I'm sure, very close to the hearts of many, many parents today. I'm in conversation with Dr. Siddharth Gogia, a very well-known and respected pediatrician of Gurgaon. So on behalf of Vega Schools, I'd like to formally welcome Dr. Gogia to this webinar. Though Dr. Gogia does not need any introduction, but let me take this opportunity to formally introduce him on this platform, as we have attendees from across the country. Dr. Siddharth Gogia is presently working as a principal consultant in the Department of Neonatology and Pediatrics at Max Hospital, Gurgaon. He also has his own clinic in Galleria. He has previously worked with Sitaram Bhartiya Institute of Science and Research in Delhi. Dr. Gogia has many achievements under his belt and has published many research papers. He also regularly presents papers internationally and has done many international workshops in the areas of neonatology and pediatrics. So, Dr. Gogia, first of all, we are very thankful to your time from your busy schedule, and you're talking to us today on this very sensitive topic. Without taking any more time, I pass on the virtual mic and the dais to Dr. Gogia.
Hi, good evening, everybody. I hope everybody's fine and doing well. I think for today's talk, I'll just start with just a general overview. I'm sure a majority of it is going to be a repetition of what you already know, but still, just to make a few points clear, and then we can then discuss something about the nutrition during these times, and finally about the reopening of the schools. So as we know that the whole thing started in December 2019, China, Wuhan city, wherein a new coronavirus was isolated. I just want to make this very clear that it's not a new virus. Okay, coronavirus is a very common cause of colds and diarrheas and vomitings, and it has been known for a long, long time. It's just that this particular strain has emerged recently. Coronavirus is a zoonosis, which means that the humans are going to get it from the animals. So here the suspected animal was bat. We have had coronaviruses, virus epidemics before also. So there was a SARS in China's severe acute respiratory syndrome, which was again mediated by bats and cats. And there was one in Saudi Arabia, which was mediated by camels. It was called MERS. So anyway, with a huge spate of undiagnosed pneumonias, which spread in Wuhan, the virus which was isolated was this coronavirus. The name COVID-19 is basically coronavirus disease 19. And so the present state of knowledge is that it is a virus which spreads from person to person, and the mode of spread is through the respiratory droplets. These are the droplets which we get out from our mouth when we exhale, when we speak, when we cough, when we sneeze. And the droplets contain a large amount of virus, and these droplets can either directly land up in the nose, mouth, or eyes of an uninfected person, or they can just drop down on fomites, for example, surfaces, you know, surface of tables, railings, doorknobs. And then when an infected person touches those things and takes his hand to his eyes, nose, or mouth, that's how you're going to get it. But it's important to realize that the virus can survive for a long time on these surfaces. And it can survive as long as 7 days on metallic surfaces. It can survive 7 days on the surface of a mask as well. Remember that. Okay. But for the routine things, for example, a bed sheet, something made up of cotton or a paper or a regular cloths, the usual survival is 1 or 2 days. It can be easily killed by routine disinfectants. I'll just come to that later. The incubation period is supposed to be as long as 14 days, which means that once the virus enters your body, you can develop symptoms within the first 14 days. And that is the reason why a quarantine is recommended for 14 days if you're exposed to it, which means if you're going to develop symptoms, you're going to develop it during that period. People who have the disease, they can continue to excrete the virus for as long as 40 days. That's like 6 weeks. Okay. So, and that is the reason why before we send these people home, initially you had to have 2 PCRs 1 day apart, which were negative, and then you could say that the person was non-infectious. But now, for want of those PCR kits, it has been arbitrarily taken as 10 days in some states, 14 days in some states, because once you are asymptomatic, the chances of you infecting somebody else decrease dramatically. Although asymptomatic people can spread the disease. So there was this confusion about a recent WHO report that asymptomatic people are not going to spread the disease. It's not true. The CDC says it's not true. We don't feel it's true because there are so many cases in which we have seen that the person is getting it, but there is absolutely no history of him being in contact with somebody who was having the disease earlier or had the disease at that time. Okay. So the symptoms, it's a respiratory virus. So the usual upper respiratory symptoms. Okay, see, the symptomatology can range from no symptoms at all to a severe lung failure, respiratory failure. So, but the commonest presentation in persons who are having symptoms is a fever, a cough, cold, a sore throat. They can also have breathing difficulty. The disease progresses. There is involvement of the gut also, which means that you can have some diarrhea, you can have vomitings. There's a lot of muscle aches and pains. There's loss of smell, loss of taste. That's also taken as a symptom. And conjunctivitis can happen, which means a red eye can also be a symptom. You would have heard of this COVID feet, which is basically just small vasculitis, which is inflammation of the blood vessels, which occurs in the periphery. So you can have it in hands and feet. And there is this presentation which sort of mimics what is called a Kawasaki disease, in which you have lymph nodes in your throat and again severe fever, I mean, between 104, 106, that kind. But that's the presentation of Kawasaki only. 50% of cases won't have fever at all. The usual course is that, the asymptomatic-symptomatic ratio is 2:1. Okay. So for every symptomatic patient, there are 2 asymptomatic patients. For the symptomatic patients, 80% of them are going to have mild symptoms. They're just going to have a regular cough, cold, and they'll be okay in a week or so. They might take 2 weeks to recover, a slightly longer one. 15% are going to have severe disease, which means they will require hospitalization, they will probably require oxygen supplementary in some way. And 5% of them are going to be critical, which means they're going to require a pressure support, they're going to require a high flow nasal cannula, or perhaps a BiPAP mask, or things like that. But it is important to understand that these 5% people who are going to have a severe disease are usually going to be either people who are more than 60 years of age, or they have some underlying medical problem. So the underlying medical problem can be diabetes, can be heart disease, can be hypertension, can be a chronic kidney disease, a chronic obstructive pulmonary disease like chronic bronchitis or emphysema, or severe asthma, or somebody who's suffering from cancer, or somebody who's taking immunosuppressive drugs for a variety of reasons. So there are a lot of immunosuppressive disorders in which you will be using steroids and cytotoxic drugs, which will put these people at risk. Now, but the situation is different in children. No, by God's grace, only 1 to 2% of COVID cases have been kids, and in those 1 to 2%, also the kids who have gotten sick are the ones who are less than 1 year of age, and that is about 15%. And again, kids with those same conditions as I mentioned earlier, you know, any underlying disease, any underlying lung problem, diabetes, hypertension, these things happen in kids too. Okay, and the kids are relatively spared from the severe disease. And so what is the importance of this point? The importance is that, you know, kids are going to play a role of asymptomatic carriers. They're not going to develop symptoms, but they're going to, you know, they can be the mechanisms of spread of the disease in the family. For example, grandchildren spreading the disease to grandparents. Okay. So now that we know how it spreads, what do we do to prevent it? So again, reinforcing those same things. First is hand washing. Okay, you're supposed to use normal soaps. There's no need to use a medicated soap. A normal soap would just be fine. Remember, you're not killing the virus by the soap, you're just washing it off. Okay, so it's important that you wash your hands vigorously, 30 seconds. There is a hand washing technique. If that is followed, that will be great. I mean, I can just show that when you are working up the lather, you are supposed to do this movement first. Okay, so you are trying to clean these interfingal folds, and then you're going to do the same thing like this, and then you are supposed to pay special attention to the thumb.
Sure.
This, then the nail beds, and then the wrist, both the sides. Do that for about 30 seconds, or alternatively, you can use a sanitizer. Usual sanitizers which are available are alcohol-based. They should contain at least 60% alcohol. There are some which contain propanol, which is absolutely fine. For cleaning of surfaces, now this is the second important thing. For surfaces, you can use alcohol. You can also use hydrogen peroxide. You can use hypochlorite. These things are easily available as a chloral bleach. Sure. It's the same thing. So that thing can be used. And then you are supposed to avoid touching your eyes, your nose, and your mouth, because these are the three portals from which the virus is going to make entry into your body. You should be wearing a mask. Okay, so there's a lot of myths about mask. Please remember, you are wearing the mask for somebody else, and somebody else is wearing the mask for you. It's not as if a normal surgical mask is going to, you know, prevent the virus which is coming from outside. You know, when you are trying to prevent infection, somebody who's coughing, who's sneezing, a huge amount of viral load will be trapped inside the mask. Okay, if you're wearing an N95 mask, as is recommended for healthcare workers, that is a kind of mask which is going to actually prevent you from having the disease if you're exposed to a higher viral load. But that's the whole point. This high viral load, you should not be exposed to it, and you won't be exposed to the high viral load if some infected person is wearing a mask. Okay, so I'm going to repeat, you are wearing the mask for somebody else, and somebody else is wearing the mask for you. So it's very, very important to wear the mask. Yeah, these cloth masks, the three-layer cotton cloth, it serves as a good purpose. But remember, it doesn't matter. Yeah, I know some people have asked me, mask, those pores in the mask, they are only about a few microns. The virus is 50 nanometer in diameter. How is it going to prevent? Oh yes, those layers. You know, if you know some physics, there's a Brownian motion of very, very small particles to the level of atoms. It says that these viruses, the virus particles, they get trapped in that. You don't need an accurate sieve. It's not as if everything is getting blocked there. Yeah. It's just the Brownian movement which stops it. So don't worry if your mask says that it's N95 mask, it's going to still, 5% time the a micron size thing is also going. So how is it going to prevent a nanometer sized virus from going? It does. There are studies. And remember, when a person coughs or sneezes, he can spread the virus up to 2 meters, which is roughly 6 feet. And hence the importance of social distancing. So as a very crude parameter, I mean, an adult's arm length is going to be 3 feet. So if like you are at two arms length from somebody else, you are maintaining social distancing. That's great. And then there is a cough etiquette. I mean, even if you are wearing a mask, if you are coughing, just cough in the crook of your elbow. Don't cough facing forward, and please don't cough facing somebody. It's very difficult to know whether you have the virus or not, as majority of people are going to be asymptomatic. So it's always better to practice cough etiquette whether you have a problem or not. Sure. All right. So as far as the indication of admission is concerned, what are we supposed to do if we develop symptoms? That's the most common question asked. Now remember, there's no straight answer to this. If you're very sick, obviously you require a hospital. But what do you do when you have only a mild cough and cold? Okay. So seeing how the health system is overwhelmed, it's not possible to admit everybody. Okay. And everybody doesn't require admission. What you basically require is monitoring. All right. So monitoring can be done over a video consult. What you need to do is, if you are having a cough and cold, if you have come in contact with somebody who has had COVID, if you have ventured out, if you think that you were not wearing a mask, your mask was faulty, or if somebody else in the family has come positive and you are having similar symptoms, then obviously you need a test. But if your symptoms are mild, which means you're not in respiratory distress, you're not having breathing difficulty, all you're having is a fever, a cough, cold, mild aches and pains, you're able to eat more than 50% of what you usually do, you're drinking enough, able to drink enough fluids that you are passing urine 4-5 times in a day, you can be managed at home. And remember, it's not as if some specific treatment is going to be started in the hospital. They're also going to treat you symptomatically only. You're going to be given paracetamol for fever. Okay. For admitted patients, everybody is being given nutrient supplements, although there is absolutely no randomized controlled trial which says that these are going to be of any benefit. Yeah, but if the disease is progressing, you are having respiratory distress, then obviously you need to be hospitalized. Sure. There are certain experimental treatments. Remember, none of them have been proven to reduce mortality. Okay. See, at the end of it, the doctor just wants to know, after 1 month, what is going to happen? With this treatment, are more people going to be saved? And if the people who are going to be people who are not being treated with the treatment, are they going to get complications? So just up till now, the treatments have just shown that an oxygen requirement is reduced, the lung clears well, the virus excretion sort of improves earlier, but net effect in mortality, that has not been shown. The only preventive medication which works to some extent is hydroxychloroquine. But again, you have to take it on a continuous basis. It's not as if you're just going to pop a pill or two, you're going to be protected. And the effect is not going to last more than 5-7 days. So which means that you have to take it on an ongoing basis, and the drug is not a very safe drug. It's full of side effects. So presently it is being reserved only for people who are coming in close contact with the cases. It's not even being recommended for regular OPD practice doctors. Okay?
Sure.
So this. So many patients, or parents rather, have asked me, what do we do about kids who are at home right now? Is there any specific medication to be given, supplements to be given, a special diet to be taken, so that this thing doesn't affect us?
That's a question that a lot of our attendees are also asking on the Q&A, that is there anything we can do to improve the immunity of our children at home?
Yeah, so see, immunity is a big term, okay? It's just that parents use it very casually. So remember, when you say the word supplement, you see, the word supplement means you are trying to treat a deficiency. Okay, supplements work when there is deficiency. There's absolutely no clinical trial which has shown that if you just start giving arbitrary vitamins and micronutrients to kids, they're going to be of any benefit or going to have any survival value. In fact, I would want everybody to Google ACE trial. You know, in 80s, it was a fad. Vitamin A, vitamin C, vitamin E, they were the antioxidants, the anti-aging vitamins. So the whole large trial was conducted with the premise that, with these three vitamins supplemented, there's going to be a decrease in age-related mortality, especially mortalities with chronic diseases, cancers, etc. the trial had to be stopped midway, you know, because there is a data safety monitoring board with every trial. So sometimes the benefit is so clear cut that you just want to stop the trial and go ahead with the results.
Sure.
Here, what the DSMB did was it stopped the trial because the supplemented group was having more cancers. Okay, so remember, vitamin supplementation is not a simple thing. I mean, you just can't pop in vitamin pills and think that it's going to be of any benefit. Remember, immune system is just like any other organ. Suppose say a muscle. All right. If I start taking too much protein, I am going to build my muscle. No. No, the protein is going to just change into fat and I am going to become fat. Unless and until I am exercising. It's the same way with the immune system. Okay, if you're already had your full of vitamins, giving supplemental vitamins is not going to be of any benefit at all. Okay. It can actually be hazardous. So I think each parent just needs to think whether with the diet that is being consumed at present, is my child getting enough vitamins, enough micronutrients or not? And let's not go into key, I'm going to give zinc supplementation and I'm going to vitamin C. I'm just,
right.
Just see the irony of it. You need 60 to 90 milligrams of vitamin C and the tablet is 500 mg. You need 2 to 10 milligrams of zinc, the tablet is 50 mg. And you are planning to take it on a daily basis. Then I will surprise you if it doesn't have side effects.
Yeah.
Okay. So I mean, just to break it up, you should be more worried about your protein intake rather than anything else. Remember, immune system, what is it producing? It is recruiting cells. Every cell major building block is protein. Antibodies building block is protein. Okay. So proteins, vitamins, calcium, iron. These are the four basic things that should be correct. Now just imagine if for a normal kid who's drinking 2 glasses of milk, you've given enough calcium. There's no need to supplement calcium. Okay. If you're eating adequate fruits and vegetables, you're eating a fruit in the morning, you're taking vegetables twice in a day, chances are that you don't need any vitamin except for vitamin D, which you get from sun.
Right.
And vitamin D supplementation is recommended for everybody. I mean, in urban India, we live in apartments, we don't have that angan. All right. And plus there is this environmental pollution, and plus we are brown people, our skin doesn't make vitamin D as occasions.
Sure.
So you need vitamin D surely.
Is it but as far as children as well? Are vitamin D supplements needed for children as well?
Absolutely. I mean, present day practice, right from day one, the thing that is prescribed is vitamin D.
Sure.
Right from a neonate in the first personal visit is going to get a prescription of vitamin D 400 IU every day in whatever form.
Okay. Sure.
So just simple foods. I mean, just imagine vitamin C requirement. A medium-sized lemon is equivalent to your vitamin C requirement. That's how less vitamin C you require. I mean, vitamin C scurvy deficiency is called scurvy. Scurvy was discovered in sailors, and to prevent that, what did they do? You're just supposed to eat a medium-sized lemon every day. That's about it. Okay, you eat more. I've had cases where, you know, there is drug-induced gastritis because the kid was given 50 milligrams of zinc, 1,000 milligrams of vitamin C, took it for 2 days, started vomiting, nausea, because it causes reflux. Vitamin C is ascorbic acid. It's acid, actually. Okay?
Sure.
So there. So much for the calcium. Then about vegetarian diet puts you at risk of iron deficiency. See, meat is very rich in iron. Anybody who's having one serving of meat every day doesn't require any iron. But when it comes to vegetarian diet, the problem is you get a good amount of iron in what? Green leafy vegetables. So all the sarso, palak, bathwa, methi, broccoli. But you know, these things are available 3 to 4 months in the whole year.
Yes.
Okay. And then the other sources, for example, jaggery, that black jaggery and dates. But somehow jaggery is not an in thing right now. Okay. So people used to eat jaggery. I mean, come to think of it, Eastern India doesn't have iron deficiency because they are eating fish.
Yes.
Up north, Kashmir doesn't have it. They are eating non-veg all the day.
Yeah.
South, they start eating chicken right from the Narmada River southwards. West, Gujaratis, pure vegetarians will put jaggery in everything. It's only the middle India. Okay. Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, UP, these people will have a milk-based diet or a cereal-based diet. Have stopped eating jaggery, have shifted to a refined sugar, and you will find that if you see the anemia map, it is exactly the center of India. Everywhere else, the anemia seems to iron deficiency anemia seems to have just disappeared. So much for the iron thing. And as far as the protein is concerned, remember, if you are drinking enough milk, milk contains a great amount of protein. One egg is, a simple egg is 6 grams of protein. 200 ml of milk is 6 grams of protein. And your protein requirement is just 1 gram per kg per day. So 1 gram per kg per day means a 15 kg old baby is going to require how much vitamin? 15 grams. If he drinks a glass of milk, 6 grams, 1 egg, 6 grams, you're already there. You just need to eat one roti. Okay, so supplementation is not worth. Supplementation will be required, you know, when you're like, suppose 40 kgs. A 12-year-old who's slightly, you know, bulky, requires more protein. Then there might be a case of protein supplementation. But here also, I would want the supplementation to be given I don't want to take names, not as Pediasure, but as food.
I was just about to ask that whether supplements like Pediasure and, you know, many others like that, why only single them out, who claim to be immunity boosters, how much of that is really true? That
see, deficiency of everything causes immunity to decrease. Protein deficiency is going to cause, protein deficiency is going to cause immunodeficiency, vitamin C, vitamin A, vitamin B, zinc, molybdenum, selenium, copper, every deficiency is going to cause immune deficiency. But sure, to say that, give these things to normal kids and they will have they'll have more immunity than anybody else. That's just not true. Okay. Sure. All these things are required for the optimal functioning of immune system. See, if your diet is good, you're probably going to have it every day. If I give you a supplement, I mean, in my clinic, the work that we do, we are very careful about what is called compliance. 60% of people have stopped their supplement in 1 month. 1 month is the most that they'll be able to give the supplement. So it is better to have good habits rather than prescribe right. All these supplements. If your diet has a normal child, 5-year-old, you're drinking 2 glasses of milk, an egg, a fruit, a vegetable, some nuts, you're eating some jaggery or dates, that's fine. Please don't count rotis, don't count rice. Yeah, if you're eating eggs, you're not worried about dal. See, just eat 2 eggs in a day and there's no need to eat dal. But I think some Indian parents are very particular about how many rotis and how much rice. That's not important, it's just a filler. I mean, rice is not going to give you any high quality micronutrient or some, you know, vitamin. And please remember, when I say all this about nutrition, remember 50 years back, there was a pediatrician who was prescribing 3 vitamins to his patients and was thinking that he was doing a great job. He didn't know there were 20 more. And 50 years hence, there is going to be a pediatrician who's going to think we are fools, we are giving only 23 vitamins, there are actually 60. And all of it has come from food only. There is absolutely no replacement for a good, balanced, healthy diet. I think instead of giving supplements, you should just concentrate on diet. It is better to see a pediatrician or like a dietitian regarding your child's diet rather than arbit giving supplements which are not required.
Absolutely. You also spoke about masks. So the question here is that what kind of mask is recommended for children? Does it have to be an N95 or what kind of mask should children be wearing when they venture out?
No. See, less than 2 years, the mask is not recommended because it presents a choking hazard, aspiration hazard, or a suffocating hazard. Above 2 years, the kids can have mask. No, you don't need N95 mask. You need a normal 3-ply cotton, the surgical mask. Just make sure that the upper border of the mask stays here. Half the time I see, you know, the mask is just hanging like that below the nose. The maximum virus concentration is in the nose, not in the throat, but in the nose. Okay, so it has to be up, and kids should be taught not to touch the outer surface or the inner surface of the mask. Remember, inner surface is still okay, but outer surface of the mask should not be touched. Something might land up here, and you might actually, then end up touching your face or nose or mouth. And yes, they should be clearly instructed that this kids have a habit of, they will touch everything. They will. That's normal exploratory behavior, but that needs to be curbed in this situation, and it is going to come only by modeling. Kids are going to do what the parents are going to do. I mean, I know 6 months before, when I you know, wore a mask just because the kid was coughing very badly. Every kid started screaming. Now they know that, you know, everybody people went. Are wearing masks, and there is absolutely no, they don't have any problem. Yeah. And if the parents are wearing masks, parents are instructing kids not to touch things here and there. Parents are instructing kids not to put, you know, bring their hand to their face.
Sure.
This is the thing which works very well. No amount of scolding or, you know, raising your voice is going to be of any benefit. It's modeling. Modeling is the best. If you want to teach a child something, just do it yourself. That's really the answer to this. And you have to hammer it again and again. Remember, they don't understand the importance of it. And so you need to really communicate with your children about this. You have to tell them that, you know, there is a disease, and this is how it spreads.
Right.
This is what we're going to do it. And please don't attach any ethnicity area to that disease. It is better to speak of people who have the disease as, you know, people who got affected, rather than, you know, COVID cases. I see small kids,
discussing,
6-year-old asking me, have you seen any COVID cases? I mean, there are cases, really. So people who have gotten affected, and please don't use words like epidemic and mahamari and all these in front of kids. It's really, you know, kids are having a tough time. They can't go out to play. They are not getting enough information. The information that they're getting is very complex for them to behold. You know, there has been an increase in kids who are coming with, you know, this blinking. It's a behavioral thing, you know, all these undiagnosed, you know, tummy pains and headaches, weakness. And this is all coming from there. You know, there have been bedwetting accidents are increasing. Kids who were toilet trained earlier have, you know, seem to have lost their ability, and it is all because of stress. And you are there in the house all the time, not able to go out and play. So I think it would be better to, you know, teach them precautions, take precautions, and go out. You're supposed to maintain social distance and not touch things. Nobody's telling you not to go out, in the evening for a walk. You are as a family, don't require social distancing, so you can just, you know, be a group, stay away from other people. Everybody can do that. But at least go out. That will decrease the stress that the kids are feeling nowadays. It's very, very important.
Sure. And going out in the air, you know, in the open, would also probably boost the immunity rather than sitting at home under the AC. Is that true?
Most definitely. Air exchanges are required. I mean, you require 3-4 air exchanges every hour. But, you know, the way now the life is that everything is just closed.
Yes.
There is just an AC vent providing that air exchange. I don't know how effective those things are. And please do a video call with every relative. That's the best stress buster. I'm against screen time. I tell my parents parents as in my client parents, not to give any screen time at all. The present recommendation for screen time is zero. But I think an exception can be made right now. And you should call your grandmother and grandfather and your uncle and aunt and all those people who haven't met. That's going to be a good stress buster. And please offer extra hugs, extra kisses. This is right now, it is required.
Yes, it is.
It is not required right now, it is never required.
It's a very difficult time for the children also. Coming to schools, what do you think, what are some of the things that schools would need to do whenever we reopen, whenever we are allowed to reopen schools? What are some of the precautions that you feel schools will need to take?
Yeah, so that's going to be a really big undertaking. Okay. So now, I think we were discussing it earlier. I told you, from 15th August, they are planning to, you know, slowly open schools. I think they are going to start with, you know, 10th standard and 12th standard, important years. It will be important to maintain social distancing.
Yes.
But then that would mean that everybody can't attend the class. Okay, so you'll probably have 30% of kids attending the class. It's going to be a task, you know, getting them to school. So I think, you know, that those private vehicles are going to be required for that, because obviously, how would you maintain adequate social distancing in a bus, right? So that would mean that the bus occupancy will have to be cut down by more than 60-70%. And then a bus, because bus will provide adequate surface, you know, all those rails and all those seats. So the schools will have to, you know, build up capacity to sort of, you know, sanitize this thing after one.
Sanitization. Yeah.
After every, and then in the school, there's going to be the question of sanitization of surfaces, provision for, you know, adequate hand sanitizer, paper towels, and it will be difficult to, you know, with 10th and 12th standard, you will still be able to sort of, you know, coach them. It will be very difficult to coach a kid who's going to, you know, KG or
yes,
whatever you call it nowadays. What is it? Kindergarten or preschool and nursery. So I think that too we can safely assume that that thing is, you know, a few more months away. I mean, a few more months away later than August 15th.
Sure.
But you know, if you have a good area, it'll be better to do classes, you know, in big areas rather than in those crammed classrooms. Sure. I mean some schools have pretty crammed areas, and it'll be difficult to them.
Just wanted to ask you in that context, you know, in our school we have open learning areas, open classrooms. So because of that, so we are not in a box classroom. So because of that, the per square feet area per child is higher than the other, you know, than in the normal times at the normal school. So is that
how much is it?
Something, it's about 150 vis-a-vis 67, 70, which is a normal number. Okay. So does that help? Will that help us in, you know, practicing social distancing when we reopen?
Yeah, it should help definitely. I mean, you see, the higher the area a child is going to get, I mean, per child, the square feet area that you are getting, your risk of having a communicable disease is going to be inversely proportional. If you are having more area, if you are having an air conditioning which has HVAC and, you know, with a HEPA filter, that's going to filter the virus. You can, so these things, if you are having a greater area, if you are having HEPA filters in place, yeah, definitely it is going to be less. Great. And if you are if you are in a big area which is constantly being filtered and ventilated, that is the sort of thing which is done in OTs, right? You have a HVAC and you have a HEPA filter, and you hope that this is going to take care of all the virus which is spreading in the air. That still wouldn't sort of protect you from somebody who's coughing directly in your face, but it's going to be of real benefit when, you know, the virus droplets are hanging in the air. Those things will definitely be filtered.
I think the amount of infection, the amount of germs, bacteria and virus would significantly probably reduce if we have an effective HVAC system, right?
Yeah, definitely. And viral load is important in this disease. Okay. If you are exposed to a high viral load, obviously there are more chances that the virus is going to overwhelm your system and cause more complications. And obviously if you're, you know, exposed to a very low viral load, you are going to develop early. So that's why I say, even if the mask is very rudimentary and is not protecting you 100%, if it is decreasing the viral load, it's still a good thing.
Sure. A lot of parents, you know, are asking that, you know, my child has, if a child has any respiratory problems like asthma, etc. So how advisable is it to be sending the child to school under such conditions? And what are the precautions that we should be taking if we decide to send them to school?
See, for somebody who has a pre-existing lung disease, okay, somebody who has bronchiectasis, somebody who has bronchial asthma, somebody who has cystic fibrosis, I mean, this is a group definitely which is, you know, a high-risk group. All right. But up till now, there has been no recommendation for a stable asthmatic. Okay, when I say stable asthmatic, which means you are on your inhalers and you haven't had an episode in last 1 year or so, or you are off your medications and you haven't had an episode, that these kids are going to be treated any differently from both. The precautions, yes. So this is going to be probably the subset in which an N95 mask is going to come in handy.
Okay.
So, and let me just say, not only for kids who are having asthma, so somebody who's having a nephrotic syndrome and is on steroids and, you know, and doing well, is controlled. ठीक है ना, बट सी दिस थिंग इज गोइंग टू रिमेन फॉर अ लॉन्ग टाइम. ओके, आई मीन इवन इफ इट पीक्स एंड स्टार्ट्स कमिंग डाउन, इट्स प्रोबब्ली गोइंग टू बी लाइक, आई मीन टिल व्हेन आर वी गोइंग टू प्रैक्टिस सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग इनटू 2021. ओके, लेट्स बी वेरी क्लियर. आई मीन obviously it will plateau, it will come down, but you won't stop practicing social distancing. It's still going to be there. Okay, the risk is still going to be there, but I mean these kids can't have a zero year, right? So you have to do something. So maybe they are not going to be, you know, included in that 15th August sort of thing, or maybe later, but all these kids who have congenital or a pre-existing chronic problem in their lungs, in their cardiovascular system, in the kidneys, in the livers, are going to be included, but they are a good candidate for wearing an N95 mask.
N95 mask, okay. Another question that a lot of parents are asking is that you know, children keep developing cough and cold, and now is no different. I mean, children do show symptoms of regular cough and cold, but in times of today, how do I ensure that it is not corona? So if my child has a cough and a cold, the first, you know, thought that will come to my mind is probably, oh, corona to nahi ho gaya. So how does one, what are the symptoms that one should be looking for? How is it different from a common cough and cold? I think that's something that a lot of parents are wanting to know.
See, if you see the symptomatology, then remember, fever, cough, cold, sore throat, this can happen. This anyway is supposed to happen 9 to 11 times in a year in every child who's less than 5 years of age. Okay, so that doesn't tell you anything at all. If symptomatology, if you are considering, then the only thing that is going to be of any help is a loss of taste and loss of smell. That's the only thing. Cough and colds, maybe you can have vomiting, you can have some crampy pain. There are so many viruses. Flu viruses will cause intense body ache. That doesn't tell you. And remember, it's not as if it's only a symptomatic baby you are considering COVID. You know, COVID can happen without any symptoms also.
Sure.
So if you are having respiratory symptoms, then the next question that I would ask is, has your child remained home during the lockdown? If yes, is there any case in your vicinity? If the answer is yes to first and no to second, which means the child has remained indoors during lockdown and the child has not been exposed to any other adult having respiratory symptoms and there is no COVID case in the vicinity, the chances the child has COVID are pretty low. Okay. In that case, if the disease is not behaving like it should, so for a normal cough and cold, you would expect there'll be some mild fever lasting 3-4 days and then it'll start coming down. That doesn't happen. Or if you think the oral intake has gone down and the child has become very lethargic, that's the second point. And thirdly, for any child who's having any kind of respiratory distress, and I mean, for my parents, I always say that you count the breathing rate when the child is sleeping and not having fever. That's a very accurate indicator whether you are having respiratory distress or not. Because sometimes, you know, respiratory distress is a very subjective thing. A mother might feel the child is having difficulty breathing, but if the child is having difficulty breathing, he's going to be breathing fast.
Sure.
You can just count the number of times. There are age-specific criteria. I don't think there's a place to discuss them. But if you think the child is having breathing difficulty, then definitely you should be consulting and getting a COVID test done. If you are having any contact with a COVID patient and the child is having symptoms, you should get a COVID test done.
Sure.
Okay, but for a normal cough and cold in which the child is up and about, normal activity, appetite more than 50%, good fluid intake, no problems at all, there is no harm in staying at home.
Okay. Another related question is, on oximeters. Now, these days, a lot of people are advocating keeping oximeters at home so that you keep monitoring the oxygen level because it is, normally said that the oxygen level drop drastically and that's when you get to know actually that you when you get the difficulty in breathing. So is that true for the children also? Should we keep checking their oxygen levels? What is your recommendation on this oximeter?
No, let me just say upfront, no, please don't do that. Okay. You are going to purchase a 1500 rupees pulse ox from Amazon. Okay. It doesn't have the capacity to measure SpO2 in a child who's even slightly moving the hand. And I have had cases where the saturation is 90 to 92. I measure it with my pulse ox, it is 99. The child is happy, active and playful. Unnecessarily, you have gotten the child outside.
Yeah.
You know, expose him to people where no clinic visit was required. Okay. And secondly, there have been some instances in which you know, the patient has had a hypoxia, the saturation has dropped down. But you know, it is almost invariably followed, oblique accompanied by a respiratory difficulty.
Sure.
You can't be having a 92 saturation and be totally asymptomatic, all right? Mm-hmm. I mean, try going to lay and see what happens. Yes. Okay, I mean, you start feeling that right then and there, young people, okay? So to say that SpO2 monitoring is going to, you know, I'll be able to make my diagnosis one day before, oh no, maybe a few hours, maybe a few hours, that too in selected people, and that too majorly in adults who have good respiratory musculature and they don't feel that thing. With a kid, the moment the oxygen saturation comes down, the child just becomes irritable and the parents know that there is something wrong with the kid.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and in that irritable state, if you are going to put in your pulse ox, you are not going to get a good reading. I mean, I also have a clip-on pulse ox, which has costed me 14,000 rupees, but still I am not able to take correct reading in a child who is very fidgety or, you know, very irritable.
Sure.
I have to send them to, you know, emergency so that they can use that wired SpO2, which is, you know, which is like a good quality thing, which can take into account the slight movement which happens with kids. It's very difficult to take an accurate reading if you're not trained for it. And you don't know the reading that you've taken has any validity or not. Because, you know, you're supposed to study the curves that that SpO2 is showing. You have to be sure that it is picking up the pulses that it should. If it is not going to pick up the pulse, then you're totally dependent upon the algorithm that is in the SpO2. Whether it is going to show the last reading, the first reading, the maximum reading, the minimum reading. I mean, you know, that's just software doing it for you. You don't get an accurate description of the child's respiratory status just by doing an SpO2 monitor reading at home.
Sure. Okay. About these sanitizers. Now, these are very strong, like you said, 60% alcohol and all of that. Now, there are children, you know, who especially at the teething stage when they keep putting their hands in the mouth. How safe is it to use a sanitizer? What is the recommended age group for using the sanitizer on a child's hand?
See, if a child is teething and putting this, nobody is telling to put the sanitizer on the hands of an infant. Okay, and there is no minimum age. Remember, if you can ensure that the child is not going to do this, that is the age. Sometimes you can make that sure in a 3-year-old. Sometimes you can't make it sure in a 5-year-old. Okay, for somebody who has a habit of thumb sucking, how are you going to make sure? So, but it is not important to use a sanitizer. You can use soap. It is not as if only sanitizers are going to be the, you know, the thing. Soap is fine. But as far as infants are concerned, no. And remember, with overuse of sanitizers, I mean, you know, there is an increase in the number of cases who are having hand dermatitis. Because, you know, they're being used constantly. They're you know, taking off the upper the stratum corneum, the upper layer of the skin. And, and remember, you know, one of the disadvantages of using a sanitizer is that sanitizer is not differentiating between good bacteria and bad bacteria. You know, your hand surface is covered with about 1,000 to 1 lakh bacteria per square inch, which are commensals, which are your friends. Okay, sanitizer is killing everything. A soap is just acting by its effect of lowering the surface tension. It is washing bacteria off. Those friendly bacteria are tightly adherent to skin. Okay, they are not washed off by soap. Only pathogenic bacteria or viruses are washed off by your soap. So it is, if you ask me which one to use between the two, I would say soap. With soap, it is. And plus, you know, you make up a good lather, and this with sanitizers, there is a chance that, you know, in those lines of your hand, the sanitizer might not go. Okay, if you're just doing a cursory thing, because with sanitizers, everybody feels overconfident. And with soap, everybody feels underconfident. It actually works for soap.
Right.
You wash your hands more vigorously when you are using soap. And
right.
with sanitizers, you are, at least the kids, they are very casual. Bas ho gaya. You know, aage peeche lag gaya and ho gaya. Nails pe gaya ki nahi gaya, andar gaya, wo nahi pata. But that is the thing that, you know, I want to emphasize. So sanitizer, if you're using sanitizer again and again, you are going to land up with some hand dermatitis, some contact dermatitis, and you are killing all the friendly bacteria. So you are sort of, in that sense, you know, making the bed fertile for those pus forming bacteria to come.
Yeah.
So unless and until you keep on using it, you will run the risk of bacterial infection.
Right. A related, question to what you said earlier, about the mental health of children. Now, you spoke about symptoms like blinking and, bedwetting and all of that. So these are signs of stress. So what can we do in these times to help, children's mental health to ensure? You spoke about it earlier, but are there any specific things that parents need to do or the environment around needs to do so that the kids feel a little less, of this situation?
See, the most important thing is to keep a healthy routine. Okay, so, just because there was no school happening in these summer vacations, kids are getting up at 12, are getting up at 1 p.m. Okay, and then they've been missing their breakfast, there was lunch, and then there's nothing to, play. So the playtime is not being replaced in any way. That's bad. Just make sure that everything goes just like it was when there was no COVID. Okay. So wake up early, just like you would on a normal school day. Okay, na? Just because there is going to be a video consult class, that means you don't need to have a bath and don't need to brush your teeth and just sit in front of that camera. That's not done. Okay. You're supposed to brush your teeth, take a bath, have your breakfast. And by the time your online class is on, you should be like, ready, spick and span, just like you were 6 months back. And because the good thing is that, at least for my kids, I'm seeing these teachers are doing a great job. The online classes are, doing very well. Everybody is being, accounted for. Ask, are you understanding or not? So the good thing is that a good amount of time the child is spending here. The bad point is that, this is giving rise to these neck problems. Everybody's still on a screen. So schools have to understand that, they are supposed to give some breaks so that, and parents are actually for older kids and especially for heavier kids should do some neck exercise to strengthen your extensors. Secondly, right now, see, there's going to be increased incidence of bad behavior right now. There's going to be arguments and there's going to be screaming and all that. Instead of going in head on, try to redirect it first. Okay, na? Just for a smaller kid, you can just engage the child in a totally different activity and he just forgets about what he was upset about. But sometimes it is not possible. Sometimes the bad behavior just continues and leads to screaming and temper tantrum. And that is the time when you give a timeout. So timeout is a cessation of all physical and social contact for 5 to 10 minutes per year of age. Which means that for a 3-year-old, you're going to give it for 15 to 30 minutes. And when I say cessation of all physical and social contact means, the regular description was that the child is actually facing the wall and, mulling about. It's supposed to ask to, consider his bad behavior. Sometimes it is not possible. The child is not going to stand against a wall. What are you going to do then? But you're actually going to isolate the child in a room where it is safe and just don't talk to the kid. And once you're done with it, please explain why he got the timeout in the first place. Please use it sparingly. Everything is not to be, confronted with the timeout. But, something like a tantrum or, hitting and all this violence or breaking things, these definitely require a timeout. And after timeout, explain why the timeout was given. And then again, you're supposed to actually, reinforce good behavior. Every time he's not doing it, he's behaving like a, good, decent bacha, then you're supposed to actually reinforce that thing. You're supposed to give something extra. It might be a hug, it might be telling a story, it might be cooking something special for him. These things work very well. So rewards and privileges, that's what we say, right? So either you take privileges or you reward them. Right. That sort of works very well.
I think what you've said about having a routine is very important, because children have been home, we've been at home and for about 3 months now, and somewhere that probably for a lot of children that routine has gone haywire. So because when they were going to school, there was a certain routine that was followed, but yes, at home they tend, even the parents tend to take it easy because some of the parents are working or whatever. But I think the point of maintaining a routine is very, very, helpful. I think that will really help solve a lot of these problems. Great. Another, question that's coming is that You know, what about the vegetables and fruits that we get from the market? A lot of times we are skeptical, on how to clean these. So is there any recommendation in terms of what we can do to actually, make sure that, these are also so-called, sanitized? I mean, of course, we can't use a sanitizer, but what's the best way of, cleaning these? Would you have any recommendations?
See, the thing is that, if a thing can be washed and peeled, it doesn't require any sanitization. Okay, so if you are just peeling the upper surface of it after washing it very carefully, you don't need to, you don't need to use sodium hypochlorite for food. I mean, I have seen these things happen, ki usko pura sanitize karenge. You see, for an apple, you can peel an apple, you can peel a mango, you can peel cucumber. If you are not peeling radish and carrot, please start peeling them. You just need to take a surface layer off. And anything which is going to be cooked anyway, you are going to get rid of it. And the virus is not going to spread just because you ate cooked food. Okay, the vegetable which is cooked properly. The surface sanitization, WHO recommendation is pretty clear. You just supposed to wash them very well. And please wash your hands after you have washed them very well. And if you are peeling everything, see, for example, onion, you're going to take the upper two layers off anyway. Okay, for majority of the things, tell me the number of things you are going to eat just like that. Apple you can eat, but I'm telling you to peel it. If you're peeling it, it doesn't matter. You're taking such a virus is a nanometer thing. If you just peel the whole thing off, wash it off, wash your hands, the virus can't come in. You don't need to be too concerned about virus coming from vegetables and food and then infecting you. At the most, it can be that, somebody really coughed on it, had a infection, and then you touched it, and then you took it in your mouth. So that's what I'm saying. Wash the vegetables and wash your hands. You're not going to get it this way. Sure. Very, very, very remote chance. The remote chance, but very remote chance.
Very remote. Great. Yeah. Since we are almost running out of time, I'll ask one last question. I think it's a question that's there in the minds of most of the parents. This is around the online classes that children are taking. So while you spoke about the neck problems and all of that, and there are solutions that you make children do exercises. What about the eyes? Are there any precautions that we can take to help the eyes, not get affected by all this screen time? So what are your recommendations on that?
So just let me take this opportunity to say ki TV dekhne se chashma nahi lagta hai. That's pretty sure. Okay. So whether you're going to have specs or not totally depends upon the size of your eye, and your size of eyes is 75% of the time determined by the size of eye of your parents. If your parents have it, you're probably going to have it. And if your parents don't have it, very less chance that you're going to have it. Okay, the main question here is of eye strain. Okay, right. which is right. I mean, you are looking at an object which is about 1 or 2 feet away. Your muscles have to contract, your eyes have to come inside, and this is a load. Just like you want to relieve stress on the back portion of your neck and the upper portion of your shoulders, you want to do the same with your eyes. So, after every half an hour to 50 minutes, that's the usual class time, 30 to 50 minutes, you're supposed to actually, do something in which you're not using your eyes to concentrate. You can't be just attending a class and then start reading your book. Okay, like your or whatever comics or whatever. So just make sure that you're just getting enough rest in between. I don't remember which committee sort of advised that if there is just a 15 minutes rest between two such classes of 50 minutes each, it's absolutely fine. So it's just 50-15. I remember that way. Okay, and kids who have allergic conjunctivitis. See, allergic conjunctivitis is very common in our country. Half the time when you have red eye, you just start putting in some antibiotic eye drops, you're not having a bacterial conjunctivitis, it's actually an allergic conjunctivitis. 15% means one in six. So these kids are going to suffer from dry eye problems. Okay, they're going to be blinking more, there's going to be some watering. If that happens and if there's some redness in your eye, you are going to benefit from those artificial tears. I see that, there are, it might just appear arcane to you, I saw my kid. The teacher is reduced to a small, you know, box, right side, lower corner. Can't see, straining. A simple thing like, you know, you could just actually enlarge the whole thing and relax, sit back comfortably. But somebody has to tell the kid to do this. And, you know, I always say that this online classes also have to be supervised. Okay, kids are very smart. Yes. Okay, there's going to be a headphone in 1 year. And I don't know if the sound is coming or not. And you're just sitting there nodding. And there's a TV samne that is being watched. So I'm sure if it can happen in my home, it can happen in your homes too. So initially I thought it was a good thing that online classes, we don't have to oversee the kid for 2 hours. But I think I go and check whether they're actually attending the class or not. They know more about gadgets than me. I had such difficulty in logging into this Zoom thing. My kid did it for me. So I think you have to ensure that they're doing. And coming back to the eyes, I forgot to say one question. If you're having this allergic conjunctivitis thing, I think during this time it would be proper to just be on your anti-allergic till the time these online classes are going on, because sure, this eye strain and fatigue is going to precipitate this thing. The season already is, you know, it's just hot and windy. This is the perfect season for that summer allergic conjunctivitis,
right.
And the cases have been increasing in the last 2-3 weeks.
Right, great. So that brings us to the end of this webinar. It's been hugely, hugely helpful. I can say, you know, as a parent, I have learned many new things that, you know, I was not aware of, and there were many myths that were there in my mind related to sanitizers, related to masks, related to school opening. You know, what should I be sending, not sending? So I think this has been a very sort of an eye-opening session personally for me also as a parent, and I'm sure the attendees also echo the same sentiments. Thank you so much, Dr. Gogia, for taking out time and you know, coming here and talking to all of us and you know, clearing so many of our doubts. For our attendees, in case you have any more questions that we could not take in today's session because of paucity of time, do write to us. You know, our email ID is available on our website, vega.edu.in. So do go to the website, and in case you have any questions for us, feel free to write to us and we'll pass them on to Dr. Gogia. Thank you. Thank you, sir. And it was really nice having you with us. Take care. Have a great day. Thank you, everyone, for attending this webinar. I hope you found it useful, and we hope to conduct many more sessions in future for the benefit of our parent community. Thank you so much.